Ladies and gentlemen, in the first place, allow me to tender my sincere thanks to the clergy of this city. I feel that I am greatly indebted to them for this magnificent audience. It has been said, and I believe it myself, that there is a vast amount of intolerance in the church of today. But when 24 clergymen, three of whom I believe are bishops, act as my advance agents without expecting any remuneration or reward in this world, I must admit that perhaps I was mistaken on the question of intolerance. And I will say further that against those men I have not the slightest feeling in the world. Every man is the product of his own surroundings. He is the product of every circumstance that has ever touched him. He is the product, to a certain degree, of the religion and creed of his day. And when men show the slightest intolerance, I blame the creed. I blame the religion. I blame the superstition that forced them to do so. I do not blame those men. Allow me to say further that this world is not, in my judgment, yet perfect. I am doing in a very feeble way, to be sure, but I am still endeavoring, according to my idea, to make this world just a little better, to give a little more liberty to men, a little more liberty to women. I believe in the government of kindness. I believe in truth, in investigation, in free thought. I do not believe that the hand of want will be eternally extended to the world. I do not believe that the prison will forever scar the ground. I do not believe that the shadow of the gallows will forever curse the earth. I do not believe that it will always be true that the men who do the most work will have the least to wear and the least to eat. I do believe that the time will come when liberty and morality and justice, like the rings of Saturn, will surround the world, that the world will be better, and every true man and every free man will do what he can to hasten the coming of the religion of human advancement. I understand that for the thousands and thousands of years that have gone by, all questions have been settled by religion. I understand that during all this time the people have gotten their information from the sacerdotal class, from priests. I know that when India was supreme they worshipped Brahma and Vishnu, and that when Rome held in its hand the red sword of war they worshipped Jove, and I know now that our religion has swept to the top. Any man living in India a few hundred or thousand years ago would have said, "This is the only true religion." Why? Because here is the only true civilization. A man afterward, living in Egypt, would have said, "This is the only true religion, because we have the best civilization." A Greek in Athens would have said, "This is the only true religion," and a Roman would have said, "We have the true religion." And now, those religions all having died, although they were all true religions, we say ours is the only religion, because we are the greatest commercial nation in the world. There will come other nations. There will come other religions. Man has made every religion in this world, in my judgment, and the religion has been good or bad according as the men who made it were good or bad. If they were savages and barbarians, they made a god like the Jehovah of the Jews. If they were civilized, if they were kind and tender, they filled the heavens with kindness and love. Every man makes his own god. Show me the god a man worships, and I will tell you what kind of man he is. Everyone makes his own god. Everyone worships his own god. And if you are a civilized man, you will have a civilized god. And we have been civilizing ours for hundreds and hundreds of years. He is getting better every day. I am going to tell you tonight just exactly what I think. The other lecture I delivered here was my conservative lecture. This is my radical one. We even hear it suggested that our religion, our Bible, has given us all we have of prosperity and greatness and grandeur. I deny it. We have become civilized in spite of it, and I will show you tonight that the obstruction that every science has had is what we have been pleased to call our religion, or superstition. I had a conversation with a gentleman once, and these gentlemen are always mistaking something that goes along with a thing for the cause of the thing, and he stated to me that his particular religion was the cause of all advancement. I said to him, "No, sir, the causes of all advancement, in my judgment, are plug hats and suspenders." And I said to him, "You go to Turkey, where they are semi-barbarians, and you won't find a pair of suspenders or a plug hat in all that country. You go to Russia, and you will find now and then a pair of suspenders at Moscow or St. Petersburg. You go on down till you strike Austria, and black hats begin. Then you go on to Paris, Berlin, and New York, and you will find everybody wears suspenders, and everybody wears black hats. Wherever you find education and music, there you will find black hats and suspenders." He said that any man who said to him that plug hats and suspenders had done more for mankind than the Bible and religion, he would not talk to. As a matter of fact, we are controlled today by men who do not exist. We are controlled today by phenomena that never did exist. We are controlled by ghosts and dead men, and in the grasp of death is a scepter that controls the living present. I propose that we shall govern ourselves. I propose that we shall let the past go, and let the dead past bury the dead past. I believe the American people have brains enough, and nerve enough, and courage enough to control and govern themselves without any assistance from dust or ghosts. That is my doctrine, and I am going to do what I can while I live to increase that feeling of independence and manhood in the American people. We can control ourselves. I believe in the gospel of this world. I believe in happiness right here. I do not believe in drinking skim milk all my life with the expectation of butter beyond the clouds. I believe in the gospel, I say, in this world. This is a mighty good world. There are plenty of good people in this world. There is lots of happiness in this world, and I say, let us, in every way we can, increase it. I envy every man who is content with his lot, whether he is poor or whether he is rich. I tell you, the man that tries to make somebody else happy and who owns his own soul, nobody having a mortgage or deed of trust upon his manhood or liberty, this world is a pretty good world for such a man. I do not care. I am going to say my say, whether I make money or grow poor, no matter whether I get high office or walk along the dusty highway of the common. I am going to say my say, and I had rather be a farmer and live on 40 acres of land, live in a log cabin that I built myself, and have a little grassy path going down to the spring so that I can go there and hear the waters gurgling and know that it is coming out from the lips of the earth like a poem whispering to the white pebbles. I would rather live there and have some hollyhocks at the corner of the house, and the larks singing and swinging in the trees, and some lattice over the window so that the sunlight can fall checkered on the babe in the cradle. I had rather live there and have the freedom of my own brain. I had rather do that than live in a palace of gold and crawl a slimy hypocrite through this world. Superstition has done enough harm already. Every religion, nearly, suspects everything that is pleasant, everything that is joyous, and they always have a notion that God feels best when we feel worst. They have chained the Andromeda of joy to the cold rock of ignorance and fear, there to be devoured by the dragon of superstition. Church and state are two vultures that have fed upon the heart of chained Prometheus. I say, let the human race have a chance. Let every man think for himself and express that thought. There is no wrath in the serene heavens. There is no scowl in the blue of the sky. Upon the throne of the universe, tyranny does not sit as king. The speaker here took from his pocket a pair of spectacles and adjusted them, saying, "I am sorry to admit it. I have got to come to it. I hate to put on a pair of spectacles, but the other day, as I was putting them on, a thought struck me. I see progress in this. To progress, is to overcome the obstacles of nature, and in order to overcome this obstacle of the loss of sight, man invented spectacles. Spectacles led men to the telescope, with which he read all the starry heavens, and had it not been for the failure of sight, we wouldn't have seen a millionth part that we have. In the first place, we owe nothing but truth to the dead. I am going to tell the truth about them. There are three theories by which men account for all phenomena, for everything that happens. First, the supernatural. In the olden time, everything that happened, some deity produced, some spirit, some devil, some hobgoblin, some dryad, some fairy, some spook